मॉर्निंग क्लास, टुडे वी डिस्कस अबाउट द सबस्टेशन एंड केबल इन यूनिट नंबर 5 इन TDEP सब्जेक्ट। नाउ वी फर्स्ट ऑन डिस्कशन अबाउट द क्लासिफिकेशन ऑफ सबस्टेशंस। फर्स्ट, बेस्ड ऑन द सर्विस, देयर आर द मेनली टू टाइप्स ऑफ बेस्ड ऑन द सर्विस। फर्स्ट वन इज द स्टेटिक्स और से इज कॉल्ड AC सबस्टेशंस, एंड सेकंड वन इज द कन्वर्टिंग which is known as the AC to DC convergence substations. Now second classification depend on the based on the function. There are mainly 6 types of substation which is defined based on the function. First one is the transformer substation, second one is the distribution substation, third one is the industrial substation, fourth one is the power factor correction substations, fifth one is the frequency changer substations, and sixth one is the switching substations. Now, third classification based on the control. There are the mainly 3 types of classification in based on control substations. First one is the manual substation, second one is the automatic substation, and third one is the supervisory substations. Now, fourth topic is based on the mounting. There are mainly 5 types of substation which is classified based on the mounting. First one is the indoor substation, second one is the outdoor substation, third one is the pole mounted substations, fourth one is the underground substations, and fifth one is the foundation mounted substations. Now we discuss about the advantages of outdoor over indoor substations. First one is the easy operations. It means the handling of the operation is very easy in outdoor substation as compared to the indoor substation. Second one is the low capital cost. It means the capital cost is low as the most of the equipment are placed in outdoor. Third one is the less required of building materials. It means it requires less building materials. Fourth one is the less time required for erections. It means this type of the substations require less time for the erections. Fifth one is the easy fault locations. It means the fault can be easily located as most of the equipment are placed outdoor. Sixth one is the less civil works. This type of substation require very less civil work. And last one is the future expansion possible. It means the future expansion is possible as large space is available outdoor. Now we discuss about the disadvantages of outdoor over indoor substations. First one is a large space required. It means this type of substation requires a large space. Thus the land cost is comparatively higher. Second is the operation in open air condition. It means the operation and maintenance are to be performed in open air during all weathering conditions. Third topic is the high maintenance. It means the maintenance is higher due to the dust deposit on the equipments as they are the placed in outdoors. Now we discuss about the comparison between outdoor and indoor substation. This comparison is showing table forms. First one is the operation. The operation of indoor substation is easy while outdoor substation is difficult. Second one is the capital cost. The capital cost of indoor substation is high while outdoor substation is less. Third topic is the space required. The space requirement is indoor substation is less while outdoor substation is high. Now next point is the civil work. The civil work of indoor substation is high while outdoor substation is less. Requirement of building materials in indoor substation is high while outdoor substation is less. Similarly, the time required for installation is more in indoor and less in outdoor substations. Location of fault in indoor substation is difficult to find while outdoor substation is easily to find. The future expansion of indoor substation is not possible while outdoor substation is possible. Operation and maintenance condition in indoor substation is in closed loop, while outdoor substation is open air. Now we discuss about the layout of substations. The incoming line is connected to the HV side bus bar. From this HV bus bar, the power is supplied to the HV side of the step down transformer. The industrial consumer, which require the incoming voltage levels, are also connected to the HV side bus bar. The secondary of the step down transformer connected to the LV side bus bar. The outgoing feeder are connected with this LV side bus bar. And the lightning arrestors, circuit breakers, isolators, current transformer, and potential transformer are to be provided for the protection, maintenance, testing, and measuring purpose. Now we discuss about the points to be considered for the selection of layout of substation. The first point is the layout of the substation should be so simple. Second point is the layout should be designed in such a way that the number of circuits and circuit breakers are reduced. And the third point is the double bus bar type arrangement is provided where necessary. Fourth point is the layout should be designed in such a way that consequential damage can be avoided in case of fault, and also it should have appropriate protections. Fifth one is the layout should be designed in such a way that the maintenance and routine inspection can be done very easily. Sixth one is the stonework and the fireproof screens should be provided for separating the equipment for the safety point of view. Seventh one is the necessary clearance between the lines and the earth should be maintained. Next one is the single line diagram of the entire substation should be mounted in the control room of the substation. And the last one is the main control equipment should be located inside the control room. Now we discuss about the transformer substation. The transformer substation are used to change the voltage level from high to low and low to high. It means the transformer substation receives the power at some voltage and they transmit the power at some other voltage. The transformer substation may be classified as below. First one is the step up substation. Second one is the primary grid substations. Third one is the secondary substations. Fourth one is the distribution substations. Now we discuss about the terminal substations. The substation in which the main line ends or terminates are known as the terminal substations. In the other words, the substation which are located either at the end of the main line or at a point away from the main line route are known as the terminal substations. The single line diagram of the terminal substation is showing below figure. The distribution substations are one type of terminal substations in which the 11 kV main line terminates at the substation. The terminal substation consists of single power line and single power transformer. The coupling capacitor and wave trap is used for the carrier communications. The protection against the lightning is also provided with the help of the lightning arrestors. Generally, the lightning arrestors are placed closer to the power transformers. Now we discuss about the through substations. The substation in which the incoming line is terminated but it passes through the same voltage are known as the through substations. In through substation, the tappings are taken from the incoming line to feed the transformer, which is shown below figure. The single line diagram of through substation is showing above figure. In this diagram, the 66 kV incoming line passed from through the substation at 66 kV outgoing line, and also the incoming line is step down the 66 kV voltage to the 11 kV for the secondary distribution. Now we discuss about the pole mounted substations. The pole mounted substation are generally used for the distribution purpose. It means they convert the 11 kV voltage into 440 volt for a 3-phase and 230 volt for single phase. This type of substation do not require any civil work, as these are the simplest and very economical form of substations. In this type of substation, all the equipments are mounted on the four pole structures. The capacity used for the pole mounted substation transformer is limited up to 200 kVA. The incoming line having the 11 kV voltage is connected to the transformer through the isolator and fuse. The pole mounted substation step down this 11 kV voltage to the 400 volt between the lines. The schematic diagram of the pole mounted substation showing figure. The lighting arrestors are provided on the HT, it means high tension side, for the protection of the substation, while the oil circuit breaker is provided on the LT, it means low tension side, for the protection against the fault, which is showing figure. Now we discuss about the underground substations. The underground substations are used where the cost of the land is very high, and if there is a shortage of land. This type of substations are generally installed with the minimum size and also proper across the equipment, and for operating personnel should be there. The schematic diagram of the underground substation is showing figure. In underground substation, all the equipment are installed in the underground. The design of the underground substation is very complicated because there are many points which should be considered with designing the substation, like good ventilations, emergency lighting, protection against firing, provision of indication for excessive rise in temperature, etc. Now we discuss about the equipment used in substations. First one is the incoming line. The incoming line supplies the power to the substation. The incoming lines are the high voltage transmission line which are coming from the transformer substation or generating stations. Second one is the outgoing line. The line which leaves the substation at the step down voltage of the transformer are known as the outgoing lines. Third one is the transformer. The main function of the transformer is to the step up or step down the voltage as per requirement. Fourth one is the on-load tap changers. The on-load tap changers changing the transformer is used to change the output voltage when the transformer secondary is connected with the load. Generally, it is placed on the high voltage side of the transformer. Nowadays, all the modern power transformers are connected with the on-load tap changers. Fifth one is a bus bar. The main function of the bus bar is to connect the number of lines electrically, which are operating at the same voltage rating. Generally, the copper or aluminum is used as a material in the construction of bus bar. Sixth one is the insulators. The main function of the insulator is to support the bus bar or conductors. The insulator also provides the insulation to the bus bars. Generally, the pin type or suspension type insulators are used, which are made from the porcelain materials. Seventh one is the reactors. The main function of the reactor is to limit the short circuit current flowing through the circuit during the faulty conditions. Eighth one is the isolators. The main function of the isolator is to isolate the part of the power system for the repair and maintenance purpose. They are placed on the both the side of circuit breakers. The isolator should be operated when there is a no load on the circuit. It means the operation of the isolator must be after ऑपरेशन ऑफ द सर्किट ब्रेकर्स. नाइन्थ वन इज सर्किट ब्रेकर. द मेन फंक्शन ऑफ द सर्किट ब्रेकर्स इज टू डिसकनेक्ट द सर्किट अंडर फॉल्टी कंडीशन. दे आर ऑपरेटेड ऑटोमेटिकली वन द फॉल्ट अकर्स ऑन द सिस्टम्स. द मैनुअल ऑपरेशन ऑफ द सर्किट ब्रेकर कैन ऑल्सो बी डन फॉर द पर्पज ऑफ मेंटेनेंस अंडर नॉर्मल कंडीशन. टेंथ वन इज द अर्थ स्विच. द अर्थ स्विच इज जनरली कनेक्टेड बिटवीन द कंडक्टर एंड अर्थ. इन नॉर्मल कंडीशन इट इज द ओपन पोजिशन. वन द लाइन इज डिसकनेक्टेड फ्रॉम द सिस्टम इट इज क्लोज टू डिस्चार्ज एंड चार्ज फ्रॉम द लाइन टू ग्राउंड. द अर्थ स्विच मस्ट बी क्लोज आफ्टर द ऑपरेशन ऑफ सर्किट ब्रेकर एंड आइसोलेटर. इलेवंथ वन इज द लाइटनिंग अरेस्टर. द मेन फंक्शन ऑफ द लाइटनिंग अरेस्टर इज टू प्रोटेक्ट द इलेक्ट्रिकल इक्विपमेंट्स अगेंस्ट द ओवर वोल्टेज सर्ज कॉज बाय द लाइटनिंग. ट्वेल्थ वन इज द कैपेसिटर बैंक्स. द मेन फंक्शन ऑफ द कैपेसिटर बैंक्स इज टू इम्प्रूव द पावर फैक्टर ऑफ द सिस्टम्स. थर्टीन इज द कंट्रोल रूम. The control room consists of instrument panels, protective relays, supervisory control equipments, cadet communication equipments, batteries, and battery charging equipments. 14th is the measuring instruments. The various measuring instruments like voltmeter, ammeter, wattmeter, kVAr meters are also used in the switchyard. Their main function is to measure the various parameters. And 15th is last is the PLCC, which full name is the Power Line Carrier Communications. The PLCC used for the communication purpose between the various stations using the power lines. Now we discussed about the layout of the control room. The control room is the brain of substation. The typical layout of control room is shown in figure. In figure, we show slotting floor for cables start to the basement, control and relay switchyard boards. Different materials are used for different switchyards in this control room. The control of various equipment like circuit breaker, voltage adjustment, load adjustment, temp changing of transformer, emergency tripping of turbines, etc. Also, the various instruments indicating the voltage, current, frequency, power factor, winding temperature, etc. are placed in the control room. It also consists of the switchboards, carrier equipment, synchronizing equipment, batteries, voltage regulators, relays, mimic diagram, etc. The main function of the relay in the power system is to sense the faulty condition and give tripping signal to the circuit breaker to disconnect the faulty part from the healthy systems. It means the relay provide the protection to the power system equipment against the faults. The switchboard consists of meters, relays and control equipment. The most necessary and important equipment are placed in the top while the other meters are placed in the bottom. Now we discuss about the equipment used in control room. First one is indicating or measuring instruments. The various indicating instruments to measure the voltage, current, frequency, power factor, winding temperature, etc. are placed in the control room. Second one is the recorder. Generally, the strip chart type, circular type or XY type recorders are used. Its main function is to record the various quantity on the time base. Fourth one is the controllers. The controllers are used to the control the various parameters like voltage, frequency, steam input to turbine, generation level, etc. Generally, the closed loop type of controller are used. Fifth one is the protective relays. The main function of the protective relays in the power system is to sense the faulty condition and give the tripping signal to the circuit breaker to disconnect the faulty part from the healthy systems. It means the relay provides the protection to the power system equipment against the faults. Sixth one is a mimic diagram. The mimic diagram is a one type of single line diagram which indicates the entire substation. इट मीन्स द इट गिव्स द ओवरऑल पिक्चर व्यू ऑफ एंटायर सबस्टेशन विद द स्टेटस ऑफ सर्किट ब्रेकर. जनरली द लैम्प्स आर यूज फॉर द इंडिकेशन ऑफ स्टेटस ऑफ ब्रेकर्स. द मिमिक बॉडी इज ऑल्सो इक्विप्ड विद द वेरियस इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स. सेवंथ वन इज एजुकेशन पैनल्स. द एजुकेशन पैनल्स प्रोवाइड द स्टेट ऑफ इक्विपमेंट इन केस ऑफ इमरजेंसी आइदर बाय ब्लिंकिंग विद द अलार्म और गिव्स द रेड कलर इंडिकेशन. लास्ट वन इज द स्विच बोर्ड्स. ऑल द मीटर्स रिलेस रिकॉर्डर कंट्रोल इक्विपमेंट एक्सेट्रा आर माउंटेड ऑन स्विच बोर्ड. द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट इक्विपमेंट आर प्लेस एट द टॉप वाइल द अदर मीटर आर प्लेस इन द बॉटम. द स्विच बोर्ड इज यूज बाय द ऑपरेटर और मॉनिटर द वोल्टेज फ्रीक्वेंसी जनरेशन लेवल एक्सेट्रा. Now we discuss about the earthing grid of substation. The earthing system consists of the metallic mesh of grid conductors and a number of vertical earth electrodes within the substation that are the connected to the mesh. The mesh is also known as the grounding or earthing grid. The mesh is buried 500 mm deep and the conductors are spaced 4 to 8 meter apart. The substation equipment are connected to the nearest mesh conductor or electrode by a metallic conductor or strip. This metallic conductor is known as the earthing conductor. The amount of the conductor and electrons required for the grid are calculated based on these values. Now we discuss about the earthing grid substations. The earthing grid of the substation shown in below figure. Now we discuss about the bus bar. So first of what is bus bar? The main function of the bus bar is connected the number of lines electrically which are the same voltage rating. The bus bar are made from the aluminium and they are in the form of pipe or conductor. There are mainly two types of bus bar. First one is a rigid type bus bar, second one is strand type bus bar. Now we discuss about the first one, the rigid type bus bar. In the rigid type bus bar, the aluminium pipes are used for making the connection between the different equipments. The pedestal insulators are used which support the bus bar and various connections. Now we discuss about the advantages of rigid type bus bar. The reliability of the rigid bus bar is more. The corona loss is less due to the large diameter of the pipes. The maintenance is very easy. Now we discuss about the disadvantages of rigid type bus bar. It requires large space and second one is they are very costly. Now we discuss about the second one, which name is the strand type bus bar. In the strand type bus bar, the aluminium conductor are used for the making the connection between different equipment. The strand insulator are used which support the bus bar and various connections. Now we discuss about the advantages of strand type bus bar. First one is they are very economical as compared as to the rigid type bus bar. They require less space as compared to the rigid type bus bar. And third one is that they are also preferable due to the shortage of aluminium pipes. Now a discussion about the points considered for selection of bus bar. The maintenance should be simple without interruption of supply. The second point is the layout should be so simple and it accommodates the future expansion due to the in case of in load demand. It should be so reliable. Fourth one, it should be so simple. Fifth one, it should be very economical. And last one, it should not be provided any danger to the operating personnel while doing maintenance. Now we discuss about the types of bus bar arrangement. First one is a single bus bar system. सेकंड वन इज अ सिंगल बस बार सिस्टम विद द सेक्शनलाइजेशन। थर्ड वन इज अ मेन एंड ट्रांसपर बस बार। फोर्थ वन इज अ डबल बस बार सिस्टम विद सिंगल ब्रेकर। फिफ्थ वन इज अ डबल बस बार सिस्टम विद अ डबल ब्रेकर। सिक्स्थ वन इज अ ब्रेकर एंड अ हाफ सिस्टम विद टू मेन बसेस। एंड लास्ट वन इज अ रिंग बस बार सिस्टम्स। नाउ वी डिस्कशन अबाउट द पोजिशन ऑफ वेरियस इक्विपमेंट इन सब स्टेशन। द स्कीमेटिक डायग्राम ऑफ द वन फेज शोइंग द टिपिकल पोजिशन ऑफ द वेरियस इक्विपमेंट इन द सब स्टेशन शो इन बिलो फिगर। Now we show the key diagram of 11 kV by 400 watt indoor substation. Now we show in the key diagram of 66 kV by 11 kV or say 66 kV by 33 kV distribution substation. Now we show the key diagram of 220 kV by 66 kV receiving substations. Now we discuss about the cable. The first one is the what is the cable? The cable is the group of one or more insulated conductor which are put together with the number of layers to give proper mechanical support to them. The conductor used in the cables are made from the copper or aluminium. Generally, the standard conductor are used with increasing the flexibility of the cable. Now, requirement of underground cable. First one is the size of the conductor. The size of the conductor must be such that it should carry the specified load without the overheating. Also, it keeps the voltage drop within the permissible limits. Second is the proper insulation. The thickness of the insulation must be such that it provides the high degree of reliability and safety at the operating voltage. Also, the cable is provided with the number of extra layers to give the proper mechanical strength. Third one is the voltage drop. The voltage drop in the cable cannot be increased beyond the permissible limits. And fourth one is the chemical and physical stability. The various material used in the construction of the cable must be provided the complete chemical and physical stability throughout the life. Now we discuss about the advantages of underground cable over the overhead line cable. First one is the continuity of supply. The continuity of supply can be maintained by underground cable as they are not affected by lightning, storms and other weather conditions. Second one is the less maintenance. The underground cable requires less maintenance, thus the maintenance cost is very low. Third one is the less accidents. The accidents caused by the breaking of the conductor are eliminated. Fourth one is the less voltage drop. The indication is very low due to the less spacing between the conductor in the cable. Thus, the voltage drawn is very low in the underground cables. Fifth one is the long life. The overall life of the underground cable is more as compared to the overhead lines. Sixth one is the attractive appearance. The appearance of the town and cities are attractive due to the underground network to the cables. Seventh one is the more safety. The underground cable are more safe as compared to the overhead lines. Last one is the no interference to communication lines. It means in underground system there is no interference to the communication lines. Now we discuss about the disadvantages of underground cable over overhead lines. First one is the more expensive. The underground cables are more expensive compared to the overhead lines due to the higher cost of insulations. Second one is difficult of joining. The joining is the difficulty in the underground system. Thus, the tappings of the lode are not so easy. Third one is difficult to locate the fault. The location of the fault in the underground system is very difficult. Fourth one is difficult maintenance. The maintenance is very difficult and expensive in the underground system. Fifth one is the high charging current. The cables have high capacitance due to the less spacing, hence it draws the high charging current. Sixth one is the future expansion. The future expansion is not possible. It can only maybe installation of new underground lines. Seventh one is higher size. The size of the conductor in the underground system is higher due to the less heat dissipation. Last one is a long distance transmission. The long distance transmission is not possible in the underground systems. Now we discuss about the construction of cable. The general construction of the cable shown below figure. First one is the core or say conductor. The core is nothing but the conductor. Its main function is to carry the current. The core consists one or more than one conductors. The cable with single conductor is known as the single core cable. Similarly, the cable with three conductor is known as the three core cables. Second one is the insulations. Each core is covered by the insulation layer of proper thickness. The thickness of the insulating layer depends on the operating voltage. The material used for the insulation are paper, varnish, vulcanized PVC, etc. Third one is the metallic sheath. The metallic sheath is provided over the insulating material. Its main function is to protect the insulating material from the moisture, gases, and any other harmful liquids in the soil. They are generally made from lead, lead alloy, or aluminium. Fourth one is the bedding. The bedding is provided over the metallic sheath. Its main function is to protect the metallic sheath from the corrosion and mechanical injury due to the armoring. It consists of paper and tape communicate with the fibrous material like jute and hessian tape. Fifth one is armoring. The armoring is provided over the bedding. Its main function is to protect the cable from the mechanical injury during its lying and handling process. It consists of one or two layers of galvanized steel wire or two layers of steel tape. Sixth one is the serving. The serving is provided over armoring. Its main function is to protect the armoring from the atmospheric condition. It consists of fibering materials like jute or cloth. Now we discuss about the classification of cable. Based on the number of core, there are mainly four types of cable. First one is a single core cable, second one is a double core cable, third one is a three core cable, fourth one is a four core cable. Based on the voltage level, there are mainly five types. First one is LT cable, which voltage level is 1 kV. Second one is a high tension cable up to 11 kV. Third one is a super tension cable up to 33 kV. Fourth one is a extra high tension cable up to 66 kV. And last one is a extra super voltage cable up to 132 kV. Based on the construction, there are the mainly six types of cable. First one is a low tension cable, second one is a belted cable, third one is a H type cable, fourth one is a SL cable, fifth one is a HSL cable, and sixth one is a super tension cable. Now based on the insulation, again the six type of cables. First one is impregnated paper insulation cable, second one is VIR cable, third one is a varnish cambric insulator cable, fourth one is a vulcanized bitumen insulator cable, fifth one is a PVC cable, and sixth one is XLPE cable. Now based on the sheath, there are mainly four types. First one is a lead sheath, second one is lead alloy sheath, third one is a PVC sheath, and fourth one is aluminium sheath. Now, based on the use, there are mainly five types. First one is a control cable, second one is a power cable, third one is a coaxial cable, fourth one is a fireproof cable, and last one is a trailing cable. Now we discuss about the insulating material used for cable. The conductor is provided with the number of layers around it. The insulation is provided around the conductor to isolate itself from the surrounding. The insulating material like paper, VIR, PVC or XLPE etc. are used for insulations. Now the types of insulating material. There are mainly four types. First one is impregnated paper, second one is a polyvinyl chloride or say PVC, third one is a vulcanized India rubber or say VIR, and fourth one is a cross-linked polyethylene. Now we discuss about the method of cable laying. There are generally three types of method which use in cable laying. First one is laying in ground, second one is raking on wall, and third one is raking in tunnel. Now we discuss about the comparison between different methods of cable, which is showing below table. First is current carrying capacity. The current carrying capacity in direct laying is very good, in drawing system is very poor, in solid system is also poor, racking on wall system is good, and racking in tunnel system is medium. Now second one we discuss our initial cost of laying in direct laying is low, in drawing system is high, solid system is high, racking in wall system is medium, and racking in tunnel system is very high. Now third one is discuss about the repairing and maintenance cost of direct laying is very high, drawing system is high, solid system is high, racking in on wall in medium, racking in tunnel system is low. Fourth one discuss about the time requirement for the locating fault in direct laying system is high, drawing system is very high, solid system is very high, racking on wall system is less, and racking in tunnel system is also less. Fifth one is the possibility of the mechanical damage in direct laying system is higher, drawing system is less, solid system in medium, racking on wall system in very less, racking in tunnel system is less. Last one is the cable replacement cost due to the growth in the demand in direct laying system is high, drawing system is medium, solid system in medium, racking on wall system in low, and racking in tunnel system is very low. Now we discuss about the selection of cable size. First one is the system voltage, second one is the types of systems, third one is the maximum continuous current, fourth one is the condition of installments, fifth one is the voltage drop, sixth one is the short circuit level of systems, seventh one is the cable laying method, and last one is the cost. Thank you.